Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Martin Rauchbauer. I'm the director of Deutsches Haus at NYU, and I want to welcome you all to tonight's ceremony. We are here to celebrate Professor Fritz Stern, who will receive in a short while the first Volkmar and Margret Sander Prize, an award that Deutsches Haus will give from now on annually to outstanding individuals who have promoted and contributed to the cultural, political, or academic relationship between Germany, or the German-speaking world, and the United States. We are overjoyed, and it is also a great honor for us that Professor Stern is here tonight with his lovely wife, and will allow us to not only award him with the prize, but also reflect on his outstanding work as a historian on Germany, on the various Germanies he has personally experienced, but also to reflect on his significance as an important figure to German-American relations. But before we do that, allow me to say a few words about the prize itself. Some of you may wonder why it is called this way and why Deutsches Haus is awarding it. Professor Volkmar Sander was the founder and first director of Deutsches Haus in 1977, so more than 36 years ago. Together with his wife Margret, who was like him, a professor at NYU's German department, Volkmar Sander established an institution with the mission to provide Americans with information on and insight into the cultural, social, political, and intellectual conditions of Germany and the German-speaking world. Deutsches Haus quickly became and has ever since been a meeting point and an intellectual platform for transatlantic exchange. In 1979, the then German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt came to visit Deutsches Haus and congratulated the Sanders for their outstanding work. In the mid-1990s, after their retirement at NYU, the Sanders returned to their native Germany, where in 2011, Volkmar Sander sadly passed away. This year, in 2013, Margret Sander established a generous fund in memory of her husband, and in order to contribute, as she put it in her own words, to the attraction and cross-cultural atmosphere of Deutsches Haus. With the fund, Deutsches Haus will be able to award for the foreseeable future every year $5,000 to the recipient of the Volkmar and Margret Sander Prize. Professor Sander, as much as she would have liked to, couldn't make the trip here tonight and be present at the ceremony, but she told me this morning on the phone how excited she was about this evening and about Professor Stern being the first recipient of the prize, whose work she has been admiring for many decades and whose books she has been rereading in recent weeks. For Deutsches Haus, this new prize is a tremendous opportunity. The Volkmar and Margret Sander Prize will not only help us to extend our small role in furthering the transatlantic relationship, a relationship that, as we have come to know over the past days, is sometimes more fragile than we think. The prize will also allow us to show our gratitude to those people who have given our mission and work inspiration and purpose. Professor Stern is admired by many people in Germany and the United States and all over the world. As a German-born American historian of Germany, a country that is universally seen and that sees itself as the cause of the horrors of two world wars and the Holocaust, Professor Stern's work was not only important for historians. A wide range of people have read and admire his work, from ordinary citizens to intellectuals, but also statesmen, politicians, and diplomats. A sign of this appreciation is surely the fact that two of the highest-ranking German diplomats are here with us tonight. I want to warmly welcome Mr. Busso von Alvensleben, the Consul General of Germany to New York, as well as Ambassador Peter Wittig, the permanent representative of Germany to the United Nations. Ambassador Wittig not only immediately agreed to hold tonight's laudation speech for Professor Stern, he and his wife, Mrs. Huberta von Voss-Wittig, whom I also want to welcome and thank here tonight, have helped us tremendously with the preparation of tonight's event. I would now like to ask Ambassador Wittig to come up to the podium and to present his laudation for Fritz Stern, first recipient of the Volkmar and Margret Sander Prize.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, dear Fritz, dear Elizabeth, thank you, Mr. Rauchbauer, for hosting us tonight. I'm truly delighted and humbled to have been chosen as a speaker in honor of Fritz Stern. I could not really imagine a better first awardee the Sander Prize. And I'm particularly pleased to announce to you tonight that I have been authorized by Federal Chancellor Angela Merkel to transmit her warm personal greetings and congratulations to Fritz Stern as he receives this wonderful prize. And this is certainly a rare tribute that the Chancellor pays to a man for whom she feels enormous respect and affection. Ladies and gentlemen, Fritz Stern arrived in New York in October 1938. His family was driven out by the Nazis just a month before Kristallnacht. The Sterns looked for a place to live. Instead of moving to Washington Heights, already known as the Fourth Reich because of its large community of German refugees, Sterns settled down in Jackson Heights in Queens, a greener borough than Manhattan. Fritz was 12 years old. He was awestruck by this new world, yet overwhelmed by the thrill of freedom. But it came with a price, tremendous insecurity. What a difference to the shielded world of his hometown in Wroclaw, Breslau in German, a prosperous and culturally vibrant Silesian city, home of a famous university, where the Sterns and their forebears, mostly physicians, had led a life as highly respected members of a proud Bildungsbürgertum. Fritz had one important asset, a battered old typewriter. So in the midst of a difficult transition from the old world to the new, he became the letter writer of the family. While his parents had to keep the family afloat, Fritz communicated with their scattered relatives in the old world and the new acquaintances in New York. Letter writing became a passion, an inner impulse of the 12-year-old. Soon he delved into politics. He appealed to New York's great mayor, LaGuardia, to run again for office. He applauded Erika Mann, the eldest daughter of Thomas Mann, for her book on German education called School for Barbarians, a subject Fritz knew about, having suffered himself from exclusion and emerging hatred as the sole non-Aryan in his school back in Germany. Observing the world around him with curiosity and engagement, writing profusely and with enthusiasm, and, like a good archivist, keeping carbon copies of his letters, it seems the young Fritz, young man Fritz, who had to arrive prematurely at the threshold of adulthood, bore already the seed of the later master historian in him. Expelled by the Nazis and belonging to a family of converted Christians, he became an American and a Jew. Yet he symbolizes what many have called the Jewish-German symbiosis. Certainly, he had already found the main topics that would shape his lifelong interest as a historian, Germany's role in the 19th and 20th century. But before embarking on that road, he briefly hesitated to decide which path to take, to follow the family tradition or his inner calling. He consulted no lesser an authority than Albert Einstein, a family acquaintance. Einstein was clear. He told young Fritz, "That's simple. Medicine is a science, and history is not. Hence, medicine." What a blessing that Einstein for once was not right. And what strength and resolve of the young Fritz Stern to rebuff a genius. Fritz Stern's brilliant early work, The Politics of Cultural Despair, identifies one of the intellectual root causes of the rise of Nazi ideology, the attack of influential intellectuals in the 19th and 20th century, Lagarde, Langbein, Müller-Fannenbrook, against modernity and liberalism, though hardly a uniquely German phenomenon, fell on particularly fertile ground in Germany, thereby undermining the fragile democracy of Weimar. Stern's warnings against the temptation of German cultural pessimism kept recurring at later junctures of the post-war Federal Republic of Germany. Of course, his undisputed masterpiece is the work on Bismarck and Bleichröder, his Jewish banker. The book is called Gold and Iron. Stern had invested 16 years of scholarly life into this book about the relations between Germans and Jews. He discovered that Bleichröder not only supervised Bismarck's growing fortune, but was deeply involved in politics and international finance, even serving intermittently as Bismarck's secret agent. Bleichröder epitomized what Stern called the anguish of assimilation. As a patriotic parvenu and the wealthiest man in Germany, he became the ideal target for the rising anti-Semitism. The historian Golo Mann, another child of Thomas Mann, called Gold and Iron one of the most important historical works of the past few decades. The historian Fritz Stern produced towering masterpieces. He was moved by the lure of working in archives, but he was also imbued with what he himself called intellectual political Wanderlust. He liked to venture into new territory. As no other historian before him, he was intrigued by the German Jewish pioneers of the modern scientific age, the second Geniezeit, at the beginning of the 20th century. His masterful portraits of Albert Einstein, Paul Ehrlich, the founder of chemotherapy and the greatest luminary of Breslau, and of Fritz Haber, Nobel Prize laureate in chemistry, and incidentally a family friend and godfather of Fritz Stern, hence the name Fritz. Those portraits are works of unparalleled intuition and sensitivity, recalling an era of German scientific excellence that prompted Raymond Aron to once say to Fritz Stern, "It could have been Germany's century." What is so alluring about Fritz Stern's way to approach history? First of all, the illuminating force of his own personal experience. His history is never bloodless positivism. It is underpinned by engagement and concern. For Fritz Stern, being a historian always means being a writer. His prose is clear, artful narrative. He rarely theorizes, hence the sheer pleasure of reading Fritz Stern. One reviewer compared his Bleichröder book to a great 19th century novel. I'm sure Fritz didn't mind that comparison. Literature has always had a firm place in his intellectual cosmos. How could it be otherwise, with a home back in Breslau, where Heinrich Heine poems were read to the children and learned by heart? The novels of Theodor Fontane were as important to his insight into 19th century Germany as any other historical source. Fritz Stern believes in the openness of history. There's no inevitability in history, no Weltgeist, no ironclad laws that predetermine the fate of nations or individuals. For the historian, that means the past contains the seeds of many futures and is open to ever-changing interpretation. Fritz Stern is a great believer in the power of ideas and the power of the individual to make a difference in history. Not only the groundbreaking decisions of leaders, but also acts of courage of individual citizens that can acquire historic force. He has a penchant for dissenters and resistors. Stern is a historical portrait artist. His intuition, his sensitivity, yes, and his refined sense of historic drama stand out. And usually, somewhere, there is a biographical thread that binds him to his figures. Take his exceptionally excellent written latest book, together with his wife Elizabeth Sifton, on Bonhoeffer and Donani, the two German resistors against Hitler. What helped him to capture the essence of their personalities with sympathy and profound knowledge of their milieu? Their families were linked in the Berlin of the 1930s. Ladies and gentlemen, undoubtedly, Fritz Stern is the master historian of contemporary Germany, but to us Germans, he's much more than that. He's one of the good spirits, as we say, ein guter Geist, of the Federal Republic of Germany. His own life story reflects the catastrophes, but also the hopes of 20th century Germany. He became not only an engaged observer of post-war Germany, but a coveted advisor and, if need be, an admonisher. I cannot think of any intellectual from abroad who commands such an enormous moral and political authority in my country. That it would turn out that way was far from self-evident. By the end of the war, the young Fritz felt relief, but also intense hatred vis-à-vis the Germans. And how could it have been otherwise in the face of Auschwitz? But a couple of years later came the turning point. Fritz Stern attended the ceremonies commemorating the 10th anniversary of the attempt on Hitler's life made on the 20th of July in 1944. In his splendid memoir, The Five Germanies I've Known, he described that day as a moving, even purging experience, meeting the families of those who had risked and lost their lives in the resistance against Hitler and yet were still denounced by many Germans as traitors, Vaterlandsverräter. He writes, and I quote, "I looked at the people in the courtyard, old, distinguished, and sadly proud, dressed in mourning, faces hardened and humbled by suffering. I felt a sense of shame of my indiscriminate hatred of Germans." End of quote. 5.5 decades later, on the 20th of July 2010, Fritz Stern returned to Berlin to honor the resistors against Hitler in the Bendler Block, that bleak place where Klaus von Stauffenberg and his circle were executed. His great speech at that day, to me, is one of the most perceptive and sensitive accounts of the men and women of the 20th of July, of their milieu, of their predicament, of their soul searching. Ladies and gentlemen, Fritz Stern became a benevolent companion, as we say, a Weggefährte, of the Federal Republic of Germany. As a great American liberal, he knew about the fragility of freedom and the human potential for evil. Having studied the dangerous consequences of illiberal cultural pessimism and of the popular misconceptions of the so-called unpolitical German, as epitomized in Thomas Mann's famous book of 1918, he is a fervent advocate of civic engagement. This is his message. Freedom is the greatest good of modern times, and civic participation in the res publica is both a duty and a privilege. There was no greater joy for him than the peaceful revolutions in Dresden, Leipzig, and Berlin that led to Germany's reunification. He coined the famous phrase of Germany's second chance, indeed, a rare gift for nations. Contrary to many Western observers who looked at German unification with apprehension, if not fear, Fritz Stern embraced it without reserve labeling the year 1989 the brightest moment in Europe's darkest century. Fritz Stern had the rare opportunity to translate his insights, the historian's lessons from the past, into practical advice and political guidance for the present. Richard Holbrooke, the brilliant and innovative ambassador to Germany, recruited him as senior advisor to the American embassy in the mid-90s. What a memorable return to Germany, Fritz Stern as a diplomat, shaping US policy in Bonn. He lived in both countries, trying to bring them together, both intellectually and politically. Ladies and gentlemen, Fritz has been endowed with a gift for friendship. Myriads of Europeans and Germans can testify to that. Two stand out in particular. He called them life-changing friendships. Ralph Dahrendorf and Marion Gräfin Dönhoff, both exceptionally brilliant, liberal, transatlantic minds. And there is, of course, Helmut Schmidt, the admired statesman whom he befriended and whose official biography he was at one point tempted to write. It seems to me that friendship for Fritz is not just an essential ingredient for individual happiness. It is a political category in the Aristotelian sense. Philia, the friendship for the good, is the glue that binds citizens, the polis, together. A body politic reduced to political power play without philia becomes soulless. We owe to Fritz Stern philia, and I include here his wonderful wife Elizabeth, and we owe to him wisdom, never propounded in the style of a righteous preceptor, but offered with humility, with rare generosity, and a fundamental human attitude. His life was shaped by the catastrophe of National Socialism. As a historian, he grappled with it, yet admitted that after a life of scholarly study, the triumph of the Nazis in Germany, a country of culture and education, retained ultimately a residue of something utterly inexplicable. He warned us who had never been tested nor tempted. He warned us against moral haughtiness in dealing with a past in which people did not know what we know now. May I add a personal note here? It was this enigma of the rise of the Nazis that turned me as a young man into a student of history and political science, and Fritz Stern became one of my intellectual lodestars. Fritz Stern once said, German-American understanding was a dictate of history, of politics, and of my own life. I'm a citizen in one country, the United States, but my love belongs to two languages. Germans are immensely grateful to you, Fritz, for your persistent, benevolent, sometimes critical involvement in post-war German affairs. You helped us to gain confidence on the path to a responsible liberal democracy and to win the trust of our neighbors, our transatlantic friends, and our partners in the world. The lessons of the past, so wisely formulated by Fritz Stern, guide us in dealing with today's challenges. I'm therefore confident that we will not miss our second chance. In times of crisis, more than ever, the German people and their leaders will not forget that our future is inextricably linked to the well-being of a peaceful and prosperous Europe and a strong transatlantic partnership. As a German, as a historian, and as a friend, it's my great privilege to honor Fritz Stern tonight. He has given us so much, his scholarly work, his humanity, and his friendship. I thank you.
We knew that Helmut Schmidt doesn't travel anymore and wouldn't be able to come here and be present at the ceremony tonight. But we wanted to let him know about the prize and the ceremony and the first recipient of the prize. And we were very happy that he immediately offered to send us a video message from his home in Hamburg. Here is former Chancellor Helmut Schmidt's message to his friend, Professor Stern.
Dear Fritz, ladies and gentlemen, first I would like to apologize for not attending the ceremony tonight. But in a few weeks' time, I'll turn 95 years, and thus I have to avoid the physical strains of a long-distance flight. However, I'm very glad to have the opportunity to send a word of gratitude to my friend Fritz Stern. I first met Fritz in spring 1976 at a conference in memoriam of Ernst Reuter, a man whom both of us did highly respect. Later on, our personal contact did intensify, and eventually it evolved into friendship. And since then, every conversation with Fritz has been an unfailing source of wisdom and of inspiration to me. For both sides of the Atlantic, Fritz Stern's work is essential to understand the drama of German history in the 20th century. As he once has written, modern German history does offer lessons in both disaster and recovery. Two times Germany had aspired greatness and dominance, and two times it led to devastation and horror. Fritz Stern has helped the Germans to grasp the singularity of crimes committed in particular against Jews and against the Polish people. At the same time, he sketched out a perspective to overcome Germany's political post-war isolation with a general acceptance of the past burdens and the adoption of Western democratic traditions as essential preconditions. On the eve of German reunification, he called upon the skeptical voices in Europe and the United States as well to take it as a reason of hope, not of fear. In his view, Germany had received the rare historical gift of a second chance. However, to promote a peaceful era of the continent, the country had to be firmly anchored into an integrated Europe. It had to meet its regained strength with the virtue of modesty and of restraint. Only in close cooperation with our neighbors, namely France and Poland in particular, only in our close cooperation Germany could be able to play a constructive role in Europe. After reunification, Fritz Stern also emphasized the necessity of intra-German reconciliation. Germany's internal divisiveness had already once in the 20th century prepared the ground for political and human disaster. He considered the way to treat Germans to be a test of the country's development towards democracy. Fritz Stern's work taught us that there is no inevitability in history, with the fragility of freedom as a simple but deep lesson. He thus regards civic engagement to be a moral and political imperative, an imperative he has more than accomplished in his own life. He has not withdrawn into the ivory tower of science, but he took on personal responsibility whenever that was necessary and possible. I'm especially thankful for his commitment as a member of the Senate of the Deutsche Nationalstiftung. On grounds of his brilliant scholarship, of his biographical background, and his personal integrity, Fritz is indeed an indispensable voice of freedom and a voice of peace as well. So I would like to conclude with words from Marion Dönhoff, our common dear friend. She once has written, "Fritz, we all owe you a lot."
I would like to warmly welcome the outstanding Spanish violist Jesus Rodolfo Rodriguez, who will give a concert this Sunday at the Manés Concert Hall and has kindly agreed to give us a brief kostprobe, a foretaste of his musical talent with Johann Sebastian Bach's Chacona. Thank you. Usually at prize ceremonies, the recipient also gets a medal or a trophy or a symbol that in some way is related to what he does. Professor Stern writes wonderful books, so we were very happy when the German company Mont Blanc generously agreed to provide Professor Stern with the iconic Meisterstück number 149. According to Mont Blanc, it is the preferred writing instrument with which international treaties and agreements are signed. Your very own signature is engraved on this pen. We don't want you to sign international treaties, but we hope you will use it for writing many more fascinating books. And I would like to now here award you with the first Volkmar and Margret Sander Prize.
I am deeply moved, but not moving. Time to joke. I do find it difficult to express my gratitude, most especially to Ambassador Wittig. In whom I recognized the friendliest colleague in history, the person who I think understood most wonderfully what I had hoped to achieve and what I had hoped to do. I can't tell you how moved I am and how grateful I am. On the other hand, I have to say to you, I'd like to meet this person that you describe, instead of the self-critical, doubting, uncertain character that I meet every day. And that I think my family may have suffered from time to time. My friends also. But it's nice, in a certain sense, to see the rounded work and the things that I aspired for. I just want to say a couple of things. The ambassador already mentioned that I had skipped, as it were, abandoned my filial obligation to become a doctor in order to follow what was already then in college a passion, and that is writing history. And when I started writing history, you have to understand there was an in 46, 48, 50, German history was both a tremendous trauma on all of us, whether you lived through it or whether you read about it. And it was the great enigma. And that one would be tempted to write about it, it seems to me perfectly obvious. Let me just say, parenthetically, the first thing I did was to find out what historians had, modern historians from Voltaire on, had written about the nature of history in something called the Varieties of History. And there I discovered, as we all know, that it is customary to refer to Leopold von Ranke as the father of modern history. And I had the good fortune that disciples of his, first of all, Friedrich Meinecke, and Friedrich Meinecke's students, Hajo Holborn and Felix Gilbert, became very good friends and mentor of mine. It's not only friendship, which I do, and I'm very grateful to you for pointing that out, do treasure as one of the greatest gifts that one can have. But mentoring or finding a person that you feel can be a mentor is immensely important. In any case, as I began writing on my own, I wasn't alone. That is to say, one had any number of historians brooding in one way or another about the same thing, about the same subject. And it is also true that I was absolutely certain, I don't think consciously, I think it was somewhere else, that you couldn't understand German history without its European context, without locating in Europe itself. I embarked on various things that I did. I'm going to diverge for a second from what I was going to say to return to the chancellor. Needless to say, I was very touched that he would take the trouble and the time to talk to us. And it suddenly brought back how I first met him. And as he said, I thought it was 77, maybe it was 76. In any case, a four-volume edition of Ernst Reuter's works had just been published, and there was a ceremony, and I was asked to give the main speech, and Schmidt was supposed to give the chancellor was supposed to talk afterwards. In the speech, I talked about Reuter, whom I greatly admired, and who, incidentally, was the first German politician who had an immense appeal to a great many Americans as well. Social Democrat, emigre in Turkey during the Nazi period, and then went back. An ardent patriot, as I told my friends at Rudensteins when I was thinking about when I was thinking of Reuter again, I remembered a line of the, I think, 18 or 19-year-old Ernst Reuter writing to his extremely conservative, nationalistic parents that he was having a very interesting time in Berlin, and that he saw, I think it was Piscator's, staging of Hamlet. And then, as if to get even with his parents after years of whatever he may have suffered, he said, and I want you to know that Hamlet is worth all of Goethe put together, which you can imagine a German bourgeois family would not readily find acceptable. And Reuter was an extraordinary leader, and it was something, and in that context, as I was talking about Reuter's life, Schmidt sitting there, I came to the point where Reuter had come to the United States when he'd been mayor in Magdeburg to see what the United States was like. And suddenly, unprepared, was the time when New York was in deep financial crisis, fiscal crisis. And Schmidt had said, you can't let New York City go bankrupt or something like that. And I said, and in this context, Mr. Chancellor, I want to transmit to you the gratitude of the citizens of New York for your advice and your help. As we both walked out together, and that was the first time I changed words with him, I said, I hope you didn't mind what I said. He said, no, I love to give unsolicited advice. which he certainly has done in his lifetime, and I wish he would do more of it now. Let me just say, as briefly as I can, that being an historian of Germany over a century and a half, let's say, different phases, and as the ambassador very kindly said, with literature in mind also, it was clear that one had to start all over again. One had to give the Germans a sense of their own past, which had been falsified over and over again. And this was not my effort. This was the effort of a great many people at the time. I would mention Dahndorf, Alan Bullock, Nipperdai, many Germans, not many Germans actually. I mean, the Germans resisted for a while. But what we were doing, and there was a loose connection among us, our community of scholars. What we were doing, we were creating a fundament for a second German democracy, for a second German republic. After the word Weimar had become, in all languages, the short term for political fatality and a political failure, it was important for Germans to realize that there was more to it than political failure, that much had been achieved, and so on and so forth. So the connection between historical understanding and politics was very, very clear. And this, when you look back from Germany 1945 to Germany 1989 and the present, you can only say it has been an astounding success story, and one that America, that was in America's national interest, and intellectual interest, humane interest, therefore, as one was doing that, as one was trying to help build a German democracy, one was fulfilling also an American national interest, serving an American purpose. I think it would be foolish, and it would not be characteristic of me, if I didn't at this point say that we're meeting at a very melancholy moment. I think we are living through, in the last few days, what may be the most serious crisis in German-American relations since the good start in the second half of the 1940s. And I'm referring, obviously, to the question of surveillance, the ill-begotten, foolish, criminal idea to listen to her cell phone, an appalling, absolutely appalling, foolish criminal act. But what is lost is the trust, or what is in danger is the trust that was built up so carefully over so many decades. And I want to end by saying that I think that is what is our job. I've accepted the pen with great pleasure, but as an admonition to go on working. And I think we all have to try to restore. Restoring trust once it's been broken or seemingly betrayed. And the Chancellor does not, I think that is very clear, does not easily make a public phone call, so to speak, to complain about what had happened. So something, and unfortunately this is true for much of Europe, that a latent anti-Americanism, a latent unease about this giant across the sea, becomes much more present and much more active in as our misdeeds, or the misdeeds of NSA and others become clear. There's a great deal of work to be done, because I think just as Germany does need Europe, and German development would have been impossible without the EU, and to both I hope they will have a continuing good relationship and good fortune. And so in concluding, I just want to say I also wish the Deutsche Haus plenty of work, plenty of success under wonderful directorship, and good fortune to all of us. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Fritz Stern.
Before we conclude and we proceed to the reception, I would like to welcome a very special group of people here tonight, the friends of Volkmar and Margret Sander. As some of you might know, Professor Volkmar Sander The founder and director of Deutsches Haus was a passionate pianist. His favorite composer was Ludwig van Beethoven. When Volkmar Sander passed away in 2011, a group of former colleagues and students of Volkmar and Margret Sander formed the Friends. Deutsches Haus wants to thank the Friends, in particular as with their help, we were able to purchase a new Steinway upright piano. And we are inaugurating this piano tonight with a short Beethoven sonata played to you tonight by Elisa Ronsheimer, a student at Yale University and currently working at Deutsches Haus. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you had a wonderful evening and continue to enjoy it and stay with us and celebrate Professor Fritz Stern. Thank you very much.